Hello and welcome. There has been a great deal of talk in India recently about two separate issues that seem to be connected to each other. One is the issue of how to patent and exclusively license the results of publicly funded research, which is the subject of a debated and contested legislative draft. And the other is how to use, or if to use at all, genetically modified or GM crops, which is typified currently by the debate over BT Brinjal. In this context, it's a great pleasure to have with us Dr. Richard Jefferson, who's been at the forefront over recent years of both of these issues in a variety of ways. Dr. Jefferson is a molecular biologist by training and has had a long and illustrious career in plant molecular biology, culminating a few years ago, as far as some of us are concerned, in his discovery of and decision to create a model of open source biology that may serve as an alternative way of bringing innovations into society. Genetically modified crops is an extremely contested area about introduction, about usage, about utility. Particularly in India, genetically modified brinjal, eggplant, is very much in the news currently. If memory serves correctly, a few years ago, there was the possibility of an alternative to Agrobacterium tumefaciens as the vector for inducing genetic modifications in crops that was to be in the open source arena. Mm-hmm. Tell us something about that and about your thoughts and opinions about the utility of genetically modified crops.
We had to actually test whether our hypothesis that patent transparency would actually allow a different set of practice rules of engagement. So when we started developing this substantial resource called the Patent Lens, patentlens.net, it went on to become the most prominent open patent facility in the world. But it's not enough to just collect like stamps. You have to actually understand what they mean in the context. So we set out to ask the basic question. If we have transparency in a particular field of biology or of invention, can we use that transparency to create an alternative? Break monopolies, basically. Well, we use the example of gene transfer. I appreciate that GMOs are intensely, as you say, contested and emotive issue in India in particular, but elsewhere in the world. In the interest of full disclosure, I should say that I actually ran the first field trial of a genetically modified crop in the environment in 1987. In fact, it was a public trial and we beat Monsanto by one day. We planted these transgenic potatoes. No one had ever had a food crop in the field and we weren't doing it to try to fix a problem. We were trying to understand. And it was a public institution called the Plant Breeding Institute, and there's some interesting history here. It was in Cambridge in the UK. So yeah, we got there, and the purpose of our trial at that time was not with the hubris of saying we know what the problem is, we're going to be out there and fix it and own the solution. It was saying, we're an institution that engages crop physiologists and agronomists and plant breeders, and they know how to design a trial to ask questions. So let's see how genes act in the field. We honestly don't know. So we used that reporter gene I told you about and fused it to certain genes in potatoes, simply asked the question. And there was a certain amount of legitimate open inquiry here. And we set out to ask the question, and we learned a lot from that. But the momentum shifted into top-down problem solving very early. So my observations were about the pushback from GMOs were quite relevant here. At the time that we did our release, I had friends in Greenpeace International, which at that time had not yet adopted GMOs as a plank for its activism. And they were extremely excited in a positive way about this experiment, thinking that maybe this will open the door for more environmentally meaningful growth of crops with fewer chemicals and more farm-level engagement in innovation. And it was generally well received. The local community, we had ecologists, we had the local farmers in a room with tea and biscuits to talk about this trial we were going to do. It was incredibly inclusive and positive, and within 3 or 4 years, everything had changed. What had happened is that we started out as a field of science for all of us, and it became a field of science for a few of us. That transition had nothing actually to do with the technology. In spite of the fact that most of the concerns are articulated about food safety or environmental safety, my assertion, and this is a hypothesis, but it's based on my 25 years of experience, is that the real concern is at a gut level about the loss of control of the most fundamental processes in our lives, which is food. health is ironically secondary to food, because if you have a good food and water supply, most health problems go away. So we are looking at the most fundamental processes in our lives, and we feel that we no longer have a vote in the proxy of who is serving us, because the large players with very high capital and quite an opaque business model have dominated the field. So I don't think it has to do, interestingly, with food or environmental safety, because those are pegs to hang a more inchoate concern on. But coming back to what happened with the GMOs, we decided in looking at the transparency of patents, and this was quite some years later, probably in 2000 or so. By that time, Monsanto and a few others had bought up everybody in the field, and it was a scorched earth of innovation ecologies. There wasn't a lot of alternative, and there wasn't a lot of variation in what was out there. So we had a hypothesis to test, and as scientists, what we like to do is we have a hypothesis and we test it, and if it fails, it probably teaches us more than when it succeeds. So we set out to say that if it really is a massive monopoly and we can expose that through a patent transparency tool like the patent lens, will that be a good thing? Will people understand that can provide alternatives? And second, could we be, as creative scientists, able to use that cartography to map an alternative course and bust a monopoly? First, does the monopoly exist? That's a legitimate question, because at this point it was just assertions. And if it does, can we work around it? Is it unassailable? Are the walls impenetrable? Or can a small, nimble team do something about it? Now, this will be evocative of Linux and Apache and many of the successes of open source software, because, of course, I wouldn't be here if the answer wasn't, yes, we could. Yes, we can. It turns out that we decided to take the first point of intervention of GMOs, the actual imming of the G's, the transfer a gene from a bacterium to a plant. Now, about 35 years ago, scientists in a variety of public institutions, public mind you, discovered a fascinating observation that a particular bacterium that was thought to be unique at that time, called agrobacterium, it lives in our gardens. Anywhere out here in Delhi, you take a spoonful of soil, besides having millions of kanamycin-resistant bacteria in every spoon, you'll also have agrobacterium. It is a natural genetic engineer. Every day, in every country in the world, maybe not in Antarctica, but certainly every agricultural country, agrobacterium is doing its little job. It's infecting plants and transferring pieces of its own DNA. So genetic modification between kingdoms happens all the time. Every day. And they're putting pieces of DNA in there that turn plants into tumors. Oh my God, this is 100% natural. And you see them on plants. They're called galls. When you have crown galls on plants, that's caused by natural genetic engineering. And I want to, if there's anyone viewing this, I want to disabuse them of a little bit of linguistic baggage. We're so used to thinking that natural is good and artificial is bad. What's the line that we draw here? If it goes through human thought and inquiry, isn't that natural? Or is natural good because it produces such things as cholera, diphtheria, HIV, AIDS, plague? Those are all natural phenomena. So is natural really the word we should be looking for, or decency? So let's come back to this. Now, we started looking at the whole GMO phenomenon and say, let's look at this gene transfer event that public universities discovered was a unique capability. So, over the years, people have discovered that if bacteria could transfer a gene into a plant, what if we remove the tumor-causing genes and instead replace it with genes that could be beneficial, could teach us something about plants, or expand their range of responses to the challenges that farmers face? So use it as a Trojan horse to fill it full of little Brad Pitts instead of tumor-causing genes. And it turned out to work very, very well. And my involvement in plant molecular biology started around those days. And it was a very exciting and heady time to realize we had a tool to actually explore how plant genes worked and how agricultural systems performed. That was very exciting.
Thank you very much for being with us here. We will continue these discussions the next time.